Brangham. Jeff Bennett and Amna Nawaz are away. On the NewsHour tonight, after some setbacks, the jury in the Trump hush money trial is filled. The U.S. and Britain target Iran with new sanctions as the world waits for Israel's response to Iran's weekend attack. And scientists sound the alarm as warming ocean waters trigger massive bleaching of the world's coral reefs.
Major funding for the PBS NewsHour has been provided by...
Actually, you don't need vision to do most things in life. It's exciting to be part of a team driving the technology forward. I think that's the most rewarding thing. People who know BDO.
A law partner rediscovers her grandmother's artistry and creates a trust to keep the craft alive. A Raymond James financial advisor gets to know you, your passions, and the way you enrich your community. Life well planned.
Certified financial planner professionals are proud to support PBS NewsHour. CFP professionals are committed to acting in their clients' best interest. More information at letsmakeaplan.org. The Candida Fund, committed to advancing restorative justice and meaningful work through investments in transformative leaders and ideas. More at CandidaFund.org. Carnegie Corporation of New York, supporting innovations in education, democratic engagement, and the advancement of international peace and security at Carnegie.org. And with the ongoing support of these individuals and institutions. This program was made possible by the Corporation for Public Broadcasting and by contributions to your PBS station from viewers like you. Thank you.
Welcome to the NewsHour. A full jury has been seated in former President Trump's criminal trial, but jury selection has had a rocky start as two previously selected jurors were dismissed. And prosecutors again accused the former president of violating a gag order and asked the judge to hold him in contempt. I'm joined now by former federal prosecutor Jessica Roth. Jessica, great to have you back on the program. Bit of a whiplash with this jury. It was up and then it was down, and now there was a full jury seated. Two issues came up with regards to these jurors being dismissed. One, a juror was worried that her identity was being revealed in the process. A second was concern over whether another juror was somehow hiding his or her true intentions about why they wanted to sit on the jury. Are those just normal concerns, especially in a case like this?
Well, they raised two distinct concerns, these two jurors. The first juror, who said that she was concerned essentially about her privacy and I think implicitly her safety because she thought that her identity essentially was being found out. That's particular to this case. You usually don't see those kinds of juror concerns about their safety and privacy in a case, for example, involving falsification of business records, which, of course, is the charge here. You might see that in an organized crime case or a terrorism case. But, of course, this is an unusual case that's at its heart a white-collar case involving the former president of the United States, but who has engaged in a pattern of conduct and speech online in particular that really has caused threats to people who are involved in legal proceedings that are associated with him. And so it's highly unusual that you would have a juror in a case like this expressing those kinds of concerns. And it's unique to the circumstances presented by Donald Trump and his followers. So that particular instance with the juror was of grave concern to me because I'm concerned not only about that juror, but about other jurors who similarly may develop concerns about their safety and privacy and those of their families as this case goes forward. The second juror presented a different kind of issue, and that was somebody who appeared possibly, to be trying to get onto the jury, potentially because of some bias that this person harbored. So a sort of motivated, biased juror who would have been potentially lying about their own past, failing to disclose something that might have caused the lawyers to strike that juror for cause or on using a peremptory challenge. And the worry with somebody like that is less about whatever it is they're concealing and more the fact that they're concealing it, because that suggests they might not be a fair and impartial juror.
I see. Prosecutors, as I mentioned, have also asked Justice Marchand to hold Trump in contempt of court, arguing that he has repeatedly violated the gag order that the judge placed on him, which bars him from attacking witnesses, jurors, the judge, you know, other members of his family. Marchand said he's going to have a hearing about this next week. Do you think that this has gotten to the point with the former president's behavior that the judge does need to issue some kind of censure or worse?
I think the judge absolutely has to take some firm action here that involves a sanction. The question is, what will the sanction be? As of the last time the district attorney's office had filed a motion in this regard and briefed it, they were asking for monetary sanctions and a reprimand and a stern warning that future conduct would lead to even more severe sanctions. They had asked for a $1,000 fine per instance in which Mr. Trump violated the order. But that was when I think there were only three instances that they were pointing to, and those involved witnesses in the case. Now what we have are instances of Mr. Trump allegedly violating the gag order, and I think that the record's pretty clear that he did, with respect to jurors who also were listed on that order, prohibiting from making comments outside of the courtroom about those people. And so I think a lot is going to turn on how the judge handles this next week, not only for these particular instances of misconduct and violations of the order, but it's going to set the tone for the rest of the case in terms of how strict he's going to run this courtroom.
Jessica Roth, always good to hear from you. Thank you so much.
My pleasure.
I'm Stephanie Tsai with NewsHour West. Here are the latest headlines. Police in New York City have arrested pro-Palestinian protesters who had set up an encampment at Columbia University. This comes a day after the school's president addressed a congressional hearing on anti-Semitism. Manoush Shafiq said students participating in the protest would be suspended. That included the daughter of U.S. Congresswoman Ilhan Omar. Police made over 100 arrests and removed the tents put up by protesters. They did not say what charges they would face. President Biden picked up endorsements from members of the Kennedy family today. It was a rebuke against Robert F. Kennedy Jr., who is running as an independent and could siphon support from the president. Members of the prominent Democratic family appeared with Biden at a campaign event in Philadelphia. Carrie Kennedy, daughter of the late RFK, said President Biden shares many of the same values as her father.
Daddy stood for equal justice, for human rights and freedom from want and fear, just as President Biden does today. Donald Trump mocks these values just as he mocks our system of laws.
On Capitol Hill, House Speaker Mike Johnson is fighting for his political survival while scrambling to get the votes for his proposed foreign aid bills. Johnson has doubled down on separate funding measures for Israel, Ukraine, and the Indo-Pacific. Hardliners within his own party are angry over further aid to Ukraine, and there have been growing calls for his removal. Votes on the bills are expected on Saturday. In Germany, authorities have arrested two German-Russian nationals for allegedly spying on behalf of Russia. One allegedly agreed to carry out attacks on U.S. military facilities in a bid to undermine support for Ukraine. A court ordered they remain in custody while prosecutors seek indictments. Germany's top security official vowed to stand with Ukraine.
Since Russia's murderous war of aggression against Ukraine, our security authorities have ramped up all protective measures against this threat from the Russian regime. We will continue to provide Ukraine with massive support and will not be intimidated.
Germany is one of the biggest suppliers of weapons to Ukraine, second only to the U.S. The World Press Photo of the Year has been chosen, a somber, topical image from Reuters photographer Mohamed Salem. His photo shows Gaza resident Inas Abu Mamar cradling the body of her 5-year-old niece, Sally. The young girl was killed alongside her mother and sister when an Israeli missile struck their home last October. Salem won the same award more than a decade ago. Back in this country, Maine's state legislature has approved sweeping new gun reform 6 months after the state's deadliest mass shooting killed 18 people. The legislation mandates background checks for private gun sales, requires waiting periods for gun purchases. It also criminalizes the sale of guns to people barred from having them. The Biden administration issued a final rule today for public lands that puts conservation on par with drilling, mining, and grazing. The rule will allow public lands to be leased for restoration in the same way companies lease land for oil extraction. The move impacts about 10% of the country's landmass. Republicans in Congress say they will attempt to repeal the rule. And a passing of note, legendary guitarist and singer Dickie Betts has died. Betts, there on the far left, was a founding member of the Allman Brothers Band. He wrote some of their biggest hits and helped pioneer the Southern rock sound. Here he is in 1981 performing his best-known song, Ramblin' Man. Betts died at the age of 80 at his home in Florida. He battled cancer. Still to come on the NewsHour, a new report looks at the high turnover of election officials. Philanthropist Melinda French Gates discussing increasing economic empowerment for women across the globe. After the end of Ethiopia's brutal civil war, famine, starvation, and an uneasy peace. And why more employers are exploring a 4-day work week.
This is the PBS NewsHour from WETA Studios in Washington and in the West from the Walter Cronkite School of Journalism at Arizona State University.
Today, the U.S. imposed new sanctions on Iran in response to Tehran's unprecedented attack last weekend on Israel. The U.S. is also vetoing an attempt in the U.N. Security Council to create an independent Palestinian state. All this as Israel continues to debate how and when to respond to Iran's attack. Nick Schifrin looks at the U.S.'s attempt to prevent even more regional escalation.
William, this afternoon, President Biden and Prime Minister Benjamin Netanyahu's top national security aides talked about Israel's potential response to the Iranian attack. U.S. officials have made it clear they think Israel should not respond militarily and are trying to increase economic and diplomatic pressure on Iran to help make their case. For the lay of the land in the U.S. and the region, we get two views. Ambassador Dennis Ross played leading roles in the Mideast peace process for more than 12 years. He is now the counselor and a distinguished fellow at the Washington Institute for Near East Policy, a Washington think tank. And Khaled Al-Gindi has participated in past Israeli-Palestinian negotiations and is now the director of the Middle East Institute's program on Palestine and Israeli-Palestinian affairs. Thanks very much. Welcome, both of you, to the NewsHour. Ambassador Ross, let me start with you, and let's start in New York. The U.S. is vetoing a resolution that would have allowed the state of Palestine to join the U.N. as a full member. U.S. allies and fellow permanent members, the United Kingdom, is abstaining, and France is voting in favor. What's your response to those votes?
Well, I'm not surprised that the Biden administration is going to veto it. I think they look at this as not just a symbolic move, but at this point, the Palestinians don't look like a state, and so I don't think they're prepared to recognize it as such in a UN context. I also think they see this as not necessarily connected to the diplomacy that they're engaged in right now with the Saudis. They clearly still have an interest in trying to reach a Saudi-Israeli normalization deal. I think they're negotiating exactly what that might mean, not only in terms of bilateral U.S.-Saudi issues in terms of defense treaty, the Saudi development of a civilian nuclear industry. But I think they're also talking about what would the Palestinian component of this understanding be? What would the Israelis have to do in terms of recognizing some kind of move or commitment towards Palestinian statehood? I think while they're negotiating that, they're not interested in having a symbolic move at the Security Council.
Khaled Al-Gindi, what's your response to the U.S. vote in New York?
The U.S. vote is not at all unexpected. I mean, we expected that the United States would veto this resolution. They've said it. They've said all along that the only possible way for a Palestinian state to emerge is through direct bilateral negotiations, which means essentially that Israel has a permanent veto over Palestinian self-determination. And so this is an attempt by Palestinians maybe to do an end run around that principle. But I think even they understood that this was not going to pass. I think President Abbas has pursued this for his own reasons. I think he's looking more and more obsolete given the destruction in Gaza. He's unable to influence either the military or the diplomatic equation and is looking for some way to be relevant.
Dennis Ross, as I mentioned, some of this effort by the U.S. to try and tamp down escalation in the region is economic. New sanctions announced on Iran today on Iran's drone program, Iran's defense industrial base, including steel production, the first time that those sanctions have been imposed in about 3 years. Does those kinds of actions help convince the Israeli government not to respond to Iran's attack with another military attack?
Look, I think it probably helps, but I'm not sure it's enough. I think the Israelis would probably be more impressed if we were closing some of the loopholes on sanctions as it relates to Iran being able to sell its oil. 91% of their oil sales are going to the Chinese. If we were doing more to basically prevent those sales, convincing the Chinese either not to go ahead or being prepared to sanction Chinese companies, that would probably be more impressive to the Israelis.
Khalid Al-Ghindi, do you believe that President Biden is doing enough to try and influence Israeli behavior, whether toward Iran or in Gaza?
Well, I agree with Ambassador Ross that it's probably not enough to convince the Israelis not to go off on their own or to pursue a military response. And I think they're going to leverage that. I think they're going to try and extract more from the United States, quite possibly up to and including the oil sanctions that Ambassador Ross mentioned. I mean, that would be definitely a game changer as far as Israel's decision making, but we're not quite there yet.
Ambassador Ross, there are some Democrats who are wanting President Biden to use more leverage on Bibi Netanyahu when it comes to Gaza especially and condition military aid until Israel takes certain steps when it comes to the war in Gaza. Do you believe the U.S. should condition military aid?
No, I've not been in favor of conditioning military aid, especially right after Israel has just been targeted with more than 350 cruise missiles, drones, and ballistic missiles. I think that would be the wrong signal to send right now, especially vis-a-vis the Iranians and many of their proxies, including Hezbollah.
Khalid Al-Ghindi, do you believe that the U.S. can exert pressure on Israel, especially when it comes to Gaza and how Israel wages that war, separate from how Israel responds to Iran?
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, there's no question that the lack of consequences is precisely why we have this humanitarian catastrophe unfolding in Gaza, where we're now at the fastest any population has reached the stage of famine in recorded history. So there's a lot that the United States could do. It can and should condition military assistance. At a very minimum, it could hold up the offensive weapons, the massive 2,000-pound bombs that do what President Biden called indiscriminate damage in Gaza and that have caused so much civilian death and suffering. So I think there are ways to condition aid that don't necessarily affect Israel's ability to mount a defense against an Iranian threat, but that would inhibit its ability to continue to cause this mass death and destruction in Gaza.
Khalid Al-Ghindi, Dennis Ross, thanks very much to you both.
Sure. Good to be with you.
Thank you.
The temperatures of the world's oceans are quite literally off the charts. That orange line, that is last year's reading. The red line at the very top, that's this year's temperature readings. One of the most severe consequences of these warming falls on the world's coral reefs, which nearly a quarter of all ocean species rely on. According to NOAA, the National Oceanic and Atmospheric Administration, scientists issued a warning due to record-breaking temperatures in 2023, which accelerated the speed of the second largest mass bleaching event across the Atlantic Pacific, and Indian Oceans. For more on the global situation and what's at stake, we are joined by Julia Baum. She's a marine ecologist and coral reefs researcher and a professor at the University of Victoria in Canada. Julia Baum, thank you so much for being here. So NOAA just issued this report showing this widespread bleaching, which is this a sign of distress in corals. We have seen reports over the years of declining health in corals. So how do you put what's happening now in the context of what we've seen before?
What we're seeing now is the fourth global coral bleaching event, as you said, and it's alarming and likely catastrophic. And what's particularly alarming about it is that in the past, these bleaching events occurred, you know, a sufficient amount of time apart that coral reefs had sufficient time to recover in between them. But now we're seeing these global coral bleaching events occur too within the past decade. So there was a mega event during the 2015-2016 El Nino that devastated coral reefs right around the world, including mass bleaching and mortality on the Great Barrier Reef and in many, many other locations. And coral reefs take many years to recover. So 10, 20, 30, 40 years to recover. So now to see another bleaching event that is very, very intense and widespread happening just 8 years later is extremely worrying.
So I mentioned briefly corals' importance in the ocean ecosystem. I mean, we love them because they're not just what we see in Jacques Cousteau and David Attenborough documentaries. They are that, but there are also many other things. Can you sort of explain, remind us of their importance?
Absolutely. So I'm a marine ecologist, so of course I think about all of the wildlife that lives on coral reefs, and you already mentioned that a quarter of the world's diversity, different species of animals in the ocean live on coral reefs, which is completely astounding when you think about the fact that coral reefs cover less than 0.1% of the surface area of the world's oceans. But coral reefs are also extraordinarily important to people. So they are worth hundreds of billions of dollars every year. And that's through things like tourism, recreation, all of the coastal protection that they provide. So when we risk losing a huge proportion of the world's coral reefs, we're actually at risk of losing all sorts of other things that are vitally important to many, many people around the planet, especially those who live really close to coral reefs and rely upon them for either their sustenance or their livelihoods.
When you look at the drivers of this warming ocean, climate change, El Nino, perhaps some other factors, what does your research indicate is most complicit in this problem?
Right. Well, it's climate change. So this is without a doubt driven by human-caused climate change. And so I want to link El Nino to that. Under climate change, El Ninos are now supercharged. And that means that they are occurring more frequently. They are at a greater intensity. So the magnitude of the heat stress that they unleash is a lot bigger. And they also can last for a much longer period. So in the past, for example, you might have had some heat stress on an individual coral reef lasting for a couple of weeks. Now we see that type of heat stress lasting for many, many months. And that causes the corals to bleach and then eventually die. So they're becoming much more serious, and that's a direct result of climate change.
We have seen over the past year all of these efforts to try to preserve the corals, pull them out of warmer oceans and store them in cooler tanks on land, sometimes cryopreserve these corals. What do you make of those efforts, and do you think overall they are going to be enough to save this ecosystem?
I think it's a tragedy that we are pushing to, you know, coral reefs and coral reef researchers to that absolute extreme. That's a triage type of response, and it's a last ditch response. Maybe it will make a little bit of a difference in some areas where it's being implemented, but it's not a solution that is going to save the world's coral reefs, and it's undoubtedly, the only thing that is going to save the world's coral reefs at this point is a rapid reduction in greenhouse gas emissions. That is absolutely certain. Anything else that we do, you know, might help a few areas here and there. And of course, that will be important in those areas where it helps. But if we are going to ensure that the world's coral reefs are still in existence in the coming decades, we have to rapidly mitigate climate change. There's no other way forward here.
All right, Julia Baum of the University of Victoria in Canada, thank you so much for talking with us.
Thank you.
A new report reveals a historic amount of turnover within local elections offices, but also the resiliency of that workforce. Stephanie Tsai takes a closer look.
The new report from the Bipartisan Policy Center, in collaboration with researchers at UCLA, acknowledges what we've been hearing from election workers since 2020, when Trump's supporters were accused of intimidating and threatening these civil servants. But while many election workers have left the field, the report finds that there are glimmers of hope. Miles Parks covers voting and election security for NPR and joins us now to help us unpack what this new data may teach us about what's to come in this election year. So, Miles Parks, the report states that turnover is not new and that for decades local election offices have dealt with this. Why is that context so important?
Well, it kind of gives a good news and a bad news, I feel like, Stephanie. I feel like on the good news, there's been all of this hyperbole over the last couple of years as this started to come out that election officials were leaving their job, kind of people freaking out about the state of the 2024 election. The fact that this isn't as new indicates to some experts that maybe the election administration profession is a little bit more prepared than for 2024 than maybe previously thought. The bad news is that the fact that turnover has been ticking up over the last 20 years indicates that there are some chronic issues with the profession outside of the threats and harassment we've heard so much about. Things like election officials saying that they are not getting enough resources. And the other thing I hear a lot from election officials is that their jobs have just gotten a lot harder over the last decade. We know that laws are changing rapidly. That can have an impact on how hard an election official's job is. And then, you know, election officials have to do things like become cybersecurity experts, become physical security experts now, in addition to just, you know, making sure people can get their ballots and making sure those ballots are counted correctly.
And some of those election workers would say that after the 2020 election in particular, things got even harder for them. You've been covering the election landscape, Miles, since 2016, including threats to election workers. I just want to remind viewers of what some of them have been going through. We spoke to election officials from both sides of the aisle in North Carolina and Pennsylvania.
In the past, candidates ran against other candidates and campaigns ran against other campaigns. And in the last several years, the people responsible for running elections have been targeted as enemies, when in reality, they are simply trying to make sure that their voters' votes get counted.
These are not high-paying jobs for a lot of folks, and they get into this work because they have a passion for serving the public, for carrying out our elections process. They do so with integrity, and yet we're at a time when their integrity is being questioned, both personally and professionally, quite often.
And we've heard of similar frustrations, Miles, among election workers here in Maricopa County, Arizona, where I'm based. Did this report show turnover has been worse in battleground states?
It did. And this was one of the most interesting data points, is that in the previous 20 years that the researchers looked at, turnover kind of impacted jurisdictions no matter their political leaning, no matter their geography. And then in 2020, what they found specifically is that turnover jumped the most in states that were competitive in the presidential election, which aligns with what we've heard from law enforcement about where there has been an uptick in threats and harassment. And I will also note, even when I talk to election administrators who are in these battleground states, even if they personally have not received the threats, they talk about how much more pressure is on them to do their jobs completely perfectly every single day, because there's just this general sense, this cloud that they could be next in terms of targeting.
You know, one of the positives, however, that came out of this report is that the data suggests even though there's been more turnover, more experienced election workers are filling the jobs. Is that across the board, or do you see more of a struggle to retain those experienced election officials in hotly contested districts?
So what we're actually seeing is kind of the inverse, is that across the board, on average, the people replacing the election officials who have left, according to this new report, on average have about 8 years of experience in the administration field. But when you look at these larger jurisdictions, which generally since 2020 have been the places, the Detroits, the Philadelphias, the Maricopa counties, highly populated areas, on average, the election officials who are replacing the people who have left there have 11 years of election administration experience, which is really surprising, I think, to the researchers I talked to. They found it oddly comforting that, you know, maybe it's not all doom and gloom ahead of 2024.
So maybe things aren't as bad as post-2020 election headlines suggest. Miles, I want to ask you about something else. You also recently have reported that despite concerns about voting access that came after the 2020 election, that new data shows it has actually gotten easier to vote since 2000. Tell me a little bit about that reporting.
Yeah, this was a really interesting report that came out recently from the Center for Election Innovation and Research that basically looked at, do people have more than just election day to be able to cast a vote? And what they found is that in 46 states and D.C., voters have some sort of option to vote early, which is a really big sea change when you think about 2 decades ago. In 2000, 86% of voters cast a ballot on election day, whereas in 2024, 97% of voters live in a place that they have the opportunity to vote early. And so when you just think about the most basic aspect of voting, filling it out, turning it in, that voters have more options to do that now than almost ever before.
As you said, it's not all doom and gloom. Miles Parks with NPR. Thanks so much, Miles.
Thanks, Stephanie.
Consider this. In at least 93 countries, it's legally acceptable to pay women less for doing the exact same job as a man. That's just one of a litany of examples where women's economic equality is denied. And these inequities impact not just women, but their children, their families, and their broader communities. The UN estimates that closing the gender gap, not just in pay, but in other ways, such as giving them more access to loans and capital, could give the global economy a $7 trillion jumpstart. These issues are a top of mind for many this week as world leaders gather in Washington, D.C. for meetings hosted by the World Bank and the International Monetary Fund. One person advocating for a more just economy is Melinda French Gates. She's the co-chair of the Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation, which is a funder of the NewsHour. Melinda Gates, welcome back to the NewsHour. So nice to have you here.
Thanks for having me, William.
So I mentioned this one fact about it's okay legally to pay women less than men, but again, that's just one example of so many. When you are here trying to convince people about this inequity existing and causing harms, what do you argue?
I'm arguing for let's fix the system. And to be honest, it's not that hard. If you look at high-income countries, we don't have it all right yet, but women are doing better in our country than in many others.
We're not immune to this.
We're not immune to this. But if you think back in our history, it was early 1970s that a woman finally didn't need her husband to sign on her bank account in our country. So if we get the regulations right in other countries and we move capital, this large-scale capital that goes from the World Bank or the IMF, but we really hook it up to the women entrepreneurs, there are literally millions of female entrepreneurs across the continent of Africa, and we make sure the loans are right size, the interest rate is paid monthly, not weekly, it isn't at an exorbitant fee, these women will actually grow not just their business, but their entire economy.
And those disparities that you're describing, those are what exist today?
Yes, they still exist in many countries. A woman can't get a loan without her husband signing off on it. So we need to fix those laws, but we also need to fix credit. Right now, a woman often doesn't have a credit score in Africa. She doesn't have the collateral to prove she's credit worthy. And yet, if we can get her on a mobile bank account, which many women are getting onto, we can start to see that she's paying bills. She's actually financially very literate, and that she can build credit, and we can help her then get a small loan to not only educate her kids, but advance the business she cares about.
So you're here talking to the World Bank and the IMF and the heads of these very large international banking structures. When you make this argument to them, are they nodding along with you? Are they looking skeptical at you? Do they appreciate what you're talking about?
I would say it's only been in about the last 8 years that the world and these large financial institutions have woken up to the opportunity that women present. If I look back 15 years when I used to come to these institutions or to the UN, we didn't really talk about women. But now people realize, like, take the United States. Women have the most purchasing power of anybody in our own country.
Right.
And so they start to see the opportunity, but they have to get their whole organization moving in that direction.
How do you explain that chasm, the disparity that exists? Again, we understand some of the societal forces at work here that we've been fighting against for generations. How do you explain that around the world?
Well, it's much the same. It's the social norms. For better or for worse, we set the world up for males. And what's happening now is that females, when you send them out into the workforce or to capitalize their small business, they run up against these systemic barriers. So a man doesn't understand their business if he's the one that's going to extend the credit or he's going to give the loan, right? They don't see the business. They don't understand it. They often have bias thinking, oh, a woman can't run a business. So we have to break down those barriers so that we show and we demonstrate that women can create society the way we want it and that we can, as investors, get a good return. And then I think you'll see vast amounts of money flow.
The good investment, a good return on investment, that always seems to be key when you're talking to bankers.
That's right. And it should be, right? We expect in our investments to have a return. But sometimes also in the financing, for instance, these large global institutions we're talking about, you have to both do some grant funding and the loan piece, because we know India is a perfect example. They put their many women in these self-help groups, and now they are lending to 42 million women-led businesses because they're seeing it's advancing the Indian economy. But there had to be grant making at the beginning to get women organized and have the mentorship and the sponsorship to then be able to know how to start their business.
I imagine there's also this suite of other complicating factors too. War, conflict, political unrest, climate change, that again, we know disproportionately falls hardest on women. And then you also have to be trying to ameliorate those things to create the conditions by which women can thrive.
Absolutely. And it's particularly difficult at the meetings right now because we've been talking about climate change, conflict is rife. But what we're trying to get the high-income countries to understand is you have to also continue these investments in Africa and across the continent of Africa and Southeast Asia, because countries want to move from low to middle to high income, and we know it's possible. Peru has done it. India has done it. South Korea used to be a recipient of aid. Now they give aid. And so if we keep making these investments, you will see peace and prosperity in those places as opposed to more conflict.
You touched on this before, but I know you're here trying to cajole bankers and the World Bank and the IMF to do better. Some of this, as you mentioned, is also pushing back on societal, cultural, oftentimes religious beliefs about the role that women should and ought to play in societies. That seems like that's a much tougher stream to swim against.
Those issues are tough to swim against, even in our own country, right? We're seeing the rollback of women's rights and health. And so when I look at those issues, I say we need to get more women, for instance, in our country, in the 7,000 seats in the state houses and in Congress and in the Senate, because women have a different lens on society and they will make different policy. In countries around the world, much is the same thing. They're trying to get more women into their parliaments because they create different policies. They see what is often unseen. They see the unpaid work women do. They see the caregiving burden of they need to care for the children and run the business. And so I think getting women into all those seats of power really will change society.
Are there examples that you point to if someone expresses skepticism about moving this rock up this huge hill that you say, look at X, this proof of concept?
Well, at large scale, I say, look at India. India really has gotten their mobile phone penetration out there. They've gotten people ID'd on their phone. People have bank accounts. It's not just men, but they've looked at the gender gap and they're trying to get more women with their own bank account. They're now scaling and getting resources out to women, and they're starting to see they're on the economic rise in a huge way. So I point to them as a large scale example of how and where this can work.
Melinda French Gates, thank you so much for being here. Great to see you.
Thanks for having me.
Ethiopia continues to face one of the worst droughts in recent history, and millions of its people are suffering from acute hunger. Back in December, the United States resumed aid shipments after previously suspending them due to concerns about theft. But starvation is still prevalent. Special correspondent Jack Hewson reports from the Tigray region in northern Ethiopia.
These might be the last days of Gebre Michael's life. After months of little or no food, he's starving. His stomach swollen from water retention that results from protein deficiency, skin stretched taut across his upper body, his heartbeat visible.
I have a hard time breathing. It gets worse each day. I'm also feeling sick in my kidney. I can't go to the toilet because everything I eat, I vomit out.
Gebre Michael is so acutely malnourished that his body is rejecting food. His wife, Gemba, grinds a few grains outside their home in Yitzhela district of northern Tigray province. This is all they have. After the rains failed to fall in August, the crops failed too. As climate change bites, Ethiopia's drought is the worst many here have ever experienced.
People here are just trying to forage the last grains and berries that they can get from this arid landscape. Food aid is beginning to arrive, but for some, it may be too late.
Millions face acute food insecurity in the region. Approximately 400 have reportedly died of starvation in Tigray and Amhara. Gebre Michael is dangerously close to becoming the next fatality.
There's nothing we can do about the pain. Our insides hurt.
The legacy of conflict visible across the region is also making the situation worse. The civil war that ended in November 2022 displaced 2.5 million. These people here in Yitzhela have fled ethnic persecution in contested Western Tigray. Among them was Desalegn Abadi Tafiri and his family.
I have so many problems. I lost my house, I lost everything. I have to beg. I ask people to help me for the sake of my babies. I ask people to support me until we get through this hard time. I used to go to local people before, but now I can't even go to them because they're also suffering themselves.
Despite this widespread suffering, in January, Ethiopian Prime Minister Abiy Ahmed was awarded the UN Food and Agriculture Organization's highest award for his contribution to rural and economic development. This for a leader accused of using starvation as a weapon of war as government forces laid siege to Tigray 2 years prior.
I am deeply honored and grateful to the UN Food and Agriculture Organization for recognizing Ethiopia's diligent efforts over the past 5 years in addressing food and nutrition security. I would like to emphasize my government's commitment to meeting zero hunger goals.
Zero hunger? That's the rhetoric. But in Tigray, the reality looks very different. Baby Lou was brought to Aida Hospital in Mekele by his mother, Alam Degafubahan, after she was unable to produce breast milk and he became dangerously underweight.
When I was pregnant, there were food shortages. When I got close to giving birth, I had so many problems. My breasts ran out of milk because I had no food.
Further down the ward are other children that had developed hydrocephalus, the swelling of the brain with spinal fluid, a condition that can be caused by malnutrition in pregnant mothers. If nothing is done, Tigray could slide into famine. But using what's termed the F word is sensitive for the government and aid agencies alike. The memory of 1984 haunts Ethiopia when pictures of the devastating famine shocked the world. 40 years later, the death rates and numbers suffering severe acute malnutrition do not now meet the UN's technical famine definition. But for Radha Getachew, interim Tigrayan president, he's not interested in semantics.
You know, I see people dying because there is no food on their plate. No amount of technical obfuscation is going to convince me that this is not hunger. Whether the F word should be avoided at this point is overly academic as far as I'm concerned.
Tigray's hunger was exacerbated by the World Food Programme and USAID suspending food deliveries last March. The grain was being systematically stolen and sold on the black market, reportedly by both the federal and Tigrayan military. After changes to prevent theft, WFP resumed shipments in August and USAID in December. But according to Mr. Getachew, it's not enough.
The response is not adequate at all. The resumption of food aid only covers 20% of what used to be the humanitarian need in Tigray. I know the federal government for quite some time has been dragging its feet to come to terms with the reality on the ground.
And the reality remains bleak. Responding to PBS NewsHour in a written statement, the Ethiopian government said it was distributing $250 million in food aid and claimed that national wheat yields had increased dramatically since 2021. But there's little sign of this supposedly bumper crop in rural Tigray. For millions facing acute hunger, the words will ring hollow. For the PBS NewsHour, I'm Jack Hewson in northern Ethiopia.
Nearly one-third of large U.S. firms are exploring new work schedules for their employees. Economics correspondent Paul Solman takes a look at some companies that are trying out a four-day, 32-hour week with the same pay.
At Metro Caring in Denver, the food pantry's crazy busy. There were 45,000 visits last year, not far off the 47,000 at the start of the pandemic.
I came out of the pandemic just exhausted, frankly.
CEO Teva Shunitsky felt overworked and overwhelmed.
I worked far too many hours. Hunger has been steadily growing. I was really feeling discouraged. I just don't see us making progress. And so that landed really heavily on me.
And on many of her coworkers.
We were experiencing a lot of burnout on staff and feeling like we were treading water around our mission.
Corey Scrivener oversees food procurement and distribution.
We have had four different food access managers in the last 4 years, and it has 1,000% been a burnout factor with every single one of the last three previous ones.
In fact, Shunitsky almost quit.
Burnout among nonprofit CEOs and nonprofit employees was higher than any other industry. Probably like 4 out of 10, left the field. I was nearly there.
Instead, though, she took a sabbatical and came back with a proposal, a four-day work week.
If you can have a more balanced life and work fewer hours, you actually bring more creativity to your job and you bring more efficiency. And those hours that you do work mean more.
Alex Pong has written about working less, runs research and innovation at nonprofit 4 Day Week Global.
If you're in an industry in which there are serious challenges with recruitment and retention, with work-life balance, or if you have concerns about the sustainability of your organization, a 4 Day Week is a great way to address all of those challenges simultaneously.
Hey, Bernie Sanders thinks so. He recently introduced a Senate bill to reduce the standard work week to 32 hours.
The sad reality is Americans now work more hours than the people of any other wealthy nation.
Now look, a shorter work week is hardly a new idea. In 1930, given ever-increasing output per person, increasing productivity that is, economist John Maynard Keynes foresaw a 15-hour work week in 100 years. In 1956, Vice President Richard Nixon predicted a four-day work week in the, quote, not too distant future. That future is yet to arrive, but thanks perhaps to COVID, companies have begun to shift.
The pandemic had forced a lot of companies to change how they had worked, and so they were more open to the idea of playing around with work time.
As were workers.
We all realize our own mortality.
Stanford's Nicholas Bloom.
You know, more than 1 million Americans have died. You should, you know, enjoy life while you're here. Work from home has been such a bonanza. So I've talked to, you know, hundreds, thousands of managers, employees, and they're kind of like, why didn't we do this earlier? And so as soon as you start thinking like that, you think, well, what else is there? And other things like, you know, the four-day week, the whole bunch of changes come into play.
Metro Caring's pilot began in late summer. The staff worked Monday through Thursday, took Fridays off. 32 hours of work, same pay.
There's definitely a learning curve, right? Like, it doesn't just like happen like you're just like, oh, I'm going to be efficient.
To get their work done in 8 fewer hours, employees turned off computer alerts, reorganized their time.
A lot of those have been around meetings and emails, not responding right away, but like setting aside concentrated blocks and how to make meetings that are normally an hour into 15 minutes.
A shortened week increases focus, says Gray Miller.
If I have to be here Monday through Friday, I am much more likely to take that half an hour sitting and drinking coffee or that 15 minutes stepping outside for a cigarette.
Integrity Pro Roofing also tried a four-day week.
There are so many tangible, tactical ways that you can give your team back that additional 8 hours of time.
CEO Ray Boy says her staff focused on tasks and projects in the morning when they were more energized, pushing meetings to the afternoon.
The average knowledge worker loses about 2 hours of productive time per day to overly long meetings, to poorly used technology or outmoded processes. So in a sense, for a lot of us, the four-day week is already here. We're just spending a full day in the office sitting around in meetings, wondering who's going to change the toner cartridge or talking about what of the football game.
In surveys completed in February at the end of Metro Caring's trial, employees reported well-being had improved. Pre-trial, just 8% were highly or very highly satisfied with their work-life balance. At the end, that figure rose to 46%. At the start of the pilot, 50% felt burned out. By the end, half that number.
Having 4 days and then a three-day weekend, oh my Lord. It is rejuvenating on all levels.
The results didn't surprise Pond. His firm helped run a 2022 trial of 61 British firms that showed benefits to workers' health and productivity when their hours were reduced.
Managers and companies also reported that people were collaborating better, that they were happier in the office. All of the important metrics trended in positive directions.
Bloom has his doubts, though.
Very productive, well-managed American companies that already, you know, pretty kick-ass in terms of how well managed they are. These places are very efficient. It's not that easy to take a day out and produce the same amount.
At Integrity Pro Roofing, a strictly four-day work week did not work year-round.
Roofing and construction tends to be very seasonal.
So employees now work fewer hours during the off-season. But
the summer and the fall is our busiest season. And so we have found that there are times where we do need to ask our team to be flexible and to come back to a five-day work week when we're experiencing that type of a high volume.
Still, Boyce remains committed to a shorter week for her employees the rest of the year.
Time is our most precious resource. We have a really short life. So if there's any ways that we could give them some additional time, that's really what we wanted to focus on.
At Metro Caring, the four-day work week created some problems of its own.
We rely on donations and foundations and grant funding to be able to exist in the way that we do. And they don't have a four-day work week. They don't have a three-day weekend. There are deadlines that are due on Friday. I often miss emails that are important that come on Fridays. We really do need to be available for some of these bigger deadlines.
As a result, CEO Chernitsky still has to put in hours on Fridays.
I don't know that all of us are to 32 hours yet. You know, I think, you know, some of us, at least on some weeks, you know, are at 35 hours. But frankly, 35 hours is way better than the 50 hours I was working prior to this trial.
Metro Caring plans to make the shorter work week permanent, even as they work out the details.
It may not be exactly like we've done the trial, right? Like, Maybe we go to a 35-hour work week, or maybe we look at a little bit more flexibility.
Different schedules, perhaps.
Maybe it looks like one team works a different set of days than another team.
And that flexibility may help with retention. Corey Scrivener thinks she'll last longer than her three predecessors.
I'm feeling really good. I'm not leaving. I broke the curse.
Scrivener bucked the burnout trend, she says, thanks in part to the four-day work week. For the PBS NewsHour, Paul Salmon.
And that is the NewsHour for tonight. I'm William Brangham. On behalf of the entire NewsHour team, thank you so much for joining us.
Major funding for the PBS NewsHour has been provided by economy for 160 years. BNSF, the engine that connects us. The ongoing support of these individuals and institutions. And friends of the NewsHour, including Leonard and Norma Glorfine and the Judy and Peter Bloom Kovler Foundation.
Certified financial planner professionals are proud to support PBS NewsHour. CFP professionals are committed to acting in their clients' best interest. More information at letsmakeaplan.org.
The Ford Foundation, working with visionaries on the front lines of social change worldwide. And with the ongoing support of these institutions. And friends of the NewsHour. This program was made possible by the Corporation for Public Broadcasting and by contributions to your PBS station from viewers like you. Thank you. This is PBS NewsHour West from WETA Studios in Washington and from our bureau at the Walter Cronkite School of Journalism at Arizona State University.
You're watching PBS.